name's Luther Cox. I'm a professional engineer. Got my mechanical engineering degree from Texas A&M, 1957. I decided that my slide rule was running a bit thin after a while, so I came to Georgia Tech in 70 to get a master's in industrial management, because at A&M I taught 5 years of engineering in 4 years. I can still give you the first lecture of every engineering class I attended. Are there any questions over the homework? Pass your homework forward and get ready for a test. That's it, precisely. How many of you have seen the movie, I think it's called Solid Numbers? Solid Numbers. It's about the NASA program and their secret weapon. They had three women. One of them, mathematical genius. If you haven't seen it, you've got to see it. It is beautiful. It is absolutely beautiful. Because while it has a great storyline, and it's on, by the way, I worked for NASA in 66, 67 time frame. So I was there. Well, I was at Huntsville. This story takes place at Langley, which is, I think, where the ladies were. And they were outstanding in supporting the NASA project. But more importantly to me, as I watched it, your computer and engineering club, right?
Yes.
Well, that's weird to me. It's weird to me. If you see the movie, you won't see slide rules on the desk. Every engineer was identifiable because they never went anyplace without the slide rule on their hip. Anywhere on campus, you could see a slide rule bouncing on their hip. You weren't without your slide rule. I put mine in a window box, so I didn't bring it with me to remind me of a time and a place when we went to the moon with slide rules. Incredible. Hey, they actually have some good things to them. You don't have to recharge them. Now, you might have to recharge this, but you don't have to recharge it. How many know what a slide rule really is? Good, you've done some studying. For the rest of you, it's a logarithmic scale. It looks like a 12-inch ruler, except that it's a logarithmic scale. And it allows you, you know, logarithms you add together, right? Okay, that's what you do with slide rule. You're adding things together. But in fact, you're multiplying or dividing. So to me, what is a computer? A computer is a tool. It's nothing more than a calculating tool, the same as a slide rule. A slide rule multiplies and divides, adding machine adds. That's a computer, it's an adding machine. It doesn't do anything more than add. I'm going to guarantee you it's stupid. It's only as smart as the people that program it. I can tell you that. I read the other day where this y'all hearing about autonomous vehicles? I read the other day where they're deciding that autonomous vehicles are going to be correct. If there's a collision with an autonomous vehicle, humans are responsible, not the robot. This is dangerous. So it brings me to my point of this. You all are going to control the future, because the computer does have a great advantage. I can remember my professor giving me a problem. He says, if this entire class worked the rest of their life in combination, they would be able to work one iteration of this problem. Now my grandson gets this for overnight work, and he's supposed to run multiple iterations of it. What does this mean? It means that you are allowed as engineers to more thoroughly analyze the problem. Analyze what? Well, every equation has variables, does it not? Variables is built into the name. How much does it vary in respect to other variables? And that's where the computer comes in super strong. Because now you can check out and see some things, a variable doesn't change much with respect to other variables. But then it hits a point where all of a sudden, wham, it hits the needle. That variable goes out of control. It's a critical point. That's what we call it. And you need to know where the critical points are. It's real simple. Now, coming back to the show, the woman was a genius in mathematics, but she'd never been taught physics. She'd never been taught engineering. And we come to the problem that we have, every one of us, and what I'm doing here, and why I'm here, is the problem of communication. It's going to be your worst problem, always. How to communicate. It's the problem we have, whether we're engineers, mathematicians, doesn't matter. But it was beautiful because at first, they couldn't communicate. Or wouldn't communicate, I think is probably a better way to say it. They didn't have any respect for each other. And as they developed respect, they improved communications in the show, and it was beautiful. But another thing I liked about it was the difference between a mathematician and an engineer. An engineer studies the sciences. Our job as engineers, by definition, is to take the knowledge of sciences and convert it into something useful like a computer or a slide rule, a cold drink bottle, a chair, a desk, calculators. That's what engineers do. But we can't do it without the mathematician. Because math is our way of analyzing things. It's absolutely fabulous. And I don't know about y'all, but I don't know everything about mathematics. So, as an engineer, I would find myself wanting to depend on mathematicians to help me. As a mathematician, I want the engineer to explain to me what it is that your problem is about, so that I can find a formula that might assist you in solving your problem. You'll see in the movie that the mathematician says, oh, you have what's basically an orbital, an elliptical path as your trajectory. And you want it to be spherical. That's the problem. Two different things. How do we change the shape of an elliptical to that of a spherical? And you'll see that she finds the solution through an ancient mathematical approach to it. You face it every day. How many of you drive cars? Everybody drives cars? Every day when you drive down the road on a straight line and you come to a curve, you transition from an infinite radius to a rather defined radius. We call that a spiral curve in transportation, highway design. You are transitioning from a straight line to a curve. You begin to curve a little bit, and then you begin to curve a lot more until you get down to your final radius of the curve. And so we're integrated with mathematics and the sciences. And our job is to make those two things work for us so that we can help others. And that's the most fabulous thing to me as an engineer. You're as much a service to humanity as doctors, nurses, or anybody else. Some of you might want to go into engineering in support of medicine, in fact. Lord, progress that's been made in that field. There are miracles in that field. I recently had the privilege of attending a public health service conference. They got up there, you know why we don't have Ebola problems anymore? Because our service people, our engineers in the field of medicine support, stomped it out. They really had to sacrifice and work and find all kinds of new techniques, but they conquered the problems of Ebola. That's what engineers do. They solve problems. Now, y'all say I'm a forensic engineer, and I am 42 years of it. My specialty was automotive collisions. That is, I call them transportation malfunctions. As you know, everybody ups the title. Mine was transportation malfunctions. Some people just call them accidents. Some call them acts of God. Some call them collisions. But basically, as in, you were going along and suddenly you weren't going along. And that's the area that I specialized in, was that in between going and not going. And for 42 years back when I started, it's interesting how knowledge has changed. When I started into the field, I had a problem convincing the court that I could actually go out 2 years after an accident happened, inspect the vehicles, inspect the scene, and be able to render an opinion about how it happened. Things like speed, direction. Anybody got an idea about how long the collision process takes?
Maybe a week.
Give me a wag.
A week?
2 minutes?
2 months?
No, the collision. The collision. See, I failed to communicate. That's my fault. Okay. The collision.
With
impact. How long does it last? It's not zero. Why? Because, see, when the bumpers touch, just before they touch, there's zero force, right? And then they touch. Well, yeah, there's a little push on each other. And then as the car comes in, it begins to collapse. It gets enough force to push the bumper back. And then the bumper pushes into the grill, and the grill pushes into the radiator, and the radiator into the motor, and the motor begins to push back, and the frame begins to do this. Collapses. That's time. Actually, most collisions occur between 80 milliseconds and a tenth of a second. By the way, it took energy to make that sound. That's part of what the engineers analyze. Actually, we kicked that out the door because it's so little. But you know how fast it takes you to blink? 0.2 seconds. Hey, as an engineer, I'm analyzing something that you can't even see. And yet I have a witness that says, I saw the whole thing. I'll swear on the Bible, I know what happened. And so what do you do when you interview them? And this was my nemesis. Yes, sir, I saw the whole thing. Well, what were you doing when this happened? Well, I was here digging a hole in the garden for my fence post. And how did you know it was natural? I heard it and I looked around. What did we just learn? Didn't see anything but what was left over. Did not see the collision. May have heard the screeching of brakes before the impact, if you question them closely. So now, here is this preacher that's sitting on the stand and done sworn on the Bible, saw the whole thing, and I'm fixing to embarrass him, and that ain't nice. Because that poor old preacher didn't see a thing that's concerning how the accident happened. What caused the accident? So in the early days, I had to overcome this kind of incredibility. Because as an expert, when I go in the courtroom, I need to be believed. Now, just so you understand, in the courtroom, there is a judge, sits up on the bench, and you better believe he is the boss of that room. Okay? I'm talking the boss. You can pray to God, but that judge is going to make the decisions right there. And then there's something in the way of a lawyer called a plaintiff. And then there's a lawyer over here, multiple lawyers usually, in the defense. And they got a client over here that either built the automobile or designed the highway or had the machinery fail on them or something like that. They sitting over here pitiful-like, and these lawyers with their hair slicked back, oh, we the good guys over here. We the good guys. And in walks the poor engineer. Now, one of those two people hired him to find out what happened. And as that engineer, it was my job to tell the truth. I don't have anything to do with these people. This guy paid me, though, to look at it. So now I'm the hired gun for this person. And that lawyer over there, he don't like me. We're tinkers who what? Okay? And his job as a lawyer, as an advocate for his client, is to make me look like the lowest worm that ever crawled out of the earth. That you couldn't believe me, that I'd lie to you in a heartbeat before you have to hit the ground. That my mama even disowns me. That's his job. Now, how good is your temper when somebody comes that nasty like? They trying to do that to you. Boy, you can't fight back directly. You sure don't want to get mad, because he wants you to get mad. He definitely wants you to get mad. Lose your temper. Say something nasty back. Oh no. Oh no. The expert, if he's done his homework and is truthful, will not go beyond the bounds of his knowledge. Okay? Because if you go beyond the bounds of your knowledge, I'm going to tell where you are. You're in the swamp with alligators biting on you. If you dare say the wrong thing, $100 million on the line, say the wrong word, lose your temper, your client's just paid up $100 million. Could be. You put his money on the line. You got quite a responsibility in that courtroom. It's like bullfight. Here's that bull coming at you, and he wants to gore you worse than anything. If you're good, you wave the red flag at him. If you're good, here's what you do. By the way, before a trial, they usually have what they call depositions. This is where you get in a room, and anything goes. You may be in a room full of lawyers, and here you are. You're the only thing edible in sight. And they're going to try and eat you. They don't even try to use a fire. They just come at you. And they don't care if you don't explain it exactly right. They really want to know what you're going to say in that courtroom is what they want to know. And so the other side gets to oppose you. Lord help you if you've got secrets you don't want to be known. Because they're going to search out your background. Mr. Cox, you married? Yes, sir. How many children you got? Six. Six. Mr. Cox, what do you do when you ain't having children? That is for real. That is for real. Happened. My own attorney was asking that dumb questions. That's what got me. You can't trust any of them lawyers. There's something, there's a quote by Shakespeare about lawyers. I don't know what it was, but it wasn't nice. They can ask you anything about anything. Now, they're not going to ask you the questions they really want to stab you with if they're planning on going to the courtroom. Now, if they really don't understand, they really want to ask you what it is that you're going to say, that's okay. You and your lawyer have to agree what you're going to say. But remember, never forget for a moment, you ain't got a representative in that legal battle. You're the lawyer. if you don't hold the ethics line, if you don't hold to the truth, you're lost. Because from then on, quote unquote, Mr. Cox here, did you lie about this? It'll be in a deposition. And I guarantee if you Google me today, you'll probably pull up at least 36 depositions. Unless you understand the technical consequences, some of them I'm going to be contradicting myself. And that happened in a trial once. Because during the trial, they can pull out your old depositions. Sisters and brothers, I've done something on the order of close to 3,000 investigations, 400 trials, and probably twice that many depositions. I cannot remember them all. But I know one thing. I followed Mother Nature's principles, and I relied upon that knowledge, which didn't change. By the way, funny as it is, we've had a lot of changes in the world. Mother Nature hasn't changed one iota. All we've done is learn more about her. Okay? Learn more about her. I'm going to guarantee you, gravity hasn't failed me yet. I'm still hanging on to this floor. And it works. Okay? So you got to hang on to the truth. So that if they feed you any facts, same opinion, you don't contradict yourself anywhere. Hold to the truth. Hold to the knowledge you have. And you won't get in trouble in the legal system. He fed me. I got one of the nicest compliments that day. It was actually an argument over whether we should or should not use reflective tape on tractor trailers, because they would pull out. On the 50-foot plus long trailers, semis, there's a yellow light in the front, a yellow light in the center, and a red light on the back on the sides. And if it's a flatbed, flatbed's about that deep, and it's black underneath. You cannot see them at night coming up on them above 40 miles per hour with your headlights. Okay? Just don't happen because you can't see that well. It does reflect. And on top of that, if you do see something reflecting, it looks like lights over the horizon kind of thing. There's no particular image. So you can't do depth perception. By the way, in this field, you have to know a lot about human nature, about how you see things, how you sense things, how you transform that into knowledge and brain. So it requires not only engineering, but a lot of biological, I think is the proper name. You gotta know how the mind works. So at any rate, he's going at me that, Mr. Cox, did you say this about this being able to see a tractor trailer broadside? I said, well, I probably did at one time or another under the proper circumstances of evidence. And he went on for about 4 or 5 questions. And I was waffling. I try and give a good, hard, direct yes, no, or here, yes, no, but, you know, and come right at it straightforward. Because you don't want to be defensive. I'm not defensive about what I know. It's here. It's for you to know. I'm here to help you. That's what being an expert witness in the room is about. So I'm waffling. So I turned to the judge, and you got to be your own attorney once in a while. So I turned to the judge. I said, Your Honor, if you'll give me about 5 minutes for that deposition, I'll quit waffling. See, I don't mess around with the jury. I try and let them know, you know, I'm here just for you. Then it's when the judge gave me that backhanded slap. He said, Mr. Cox, you're a sophisticated witness. Answer the questions. Well, the good Lord was on my side about one more question, and I realized which deposition he was talking. Sure enough, there was a highway patrolman that had testified facts that I couldn't contradict, and therefore I had to render an opposite opinion. And so I ate him up when I finally got there, but they can get you in some bad positions. How many of you made 100 on the last exam? Good, we got 2.
I was close.
You're close. Okay, my son took a course in accident reconstruction. He's got a high school education. The Navy taught him some technical stuff. He's actually a former fire chief of Atlanta, so he's a pretty smart boy. He took the course down at Forsyth where they teach it. It's about an 80-hour course. And course, you understand that if you teach high school level type courses, you don't get into the college level courses. But he came out as an action reconstructionist. He had a certificate. He said, Dad, I made 85 on the final exam. I said, that's wonderful, son. You learned quite a bit. I said, you understand, if you and I go in the courtroom, it's the other 15% I have to testify about. Well, you don't know. Now, I apply that to you as well. When you take a course, in any course, they're good to get the fundamentals into you. They're just teaching the fundamentals. True knowledge doesn't come about until you've had time to take that knowledge apart and inspect it closely and see what it's like in action. Y'all remember this, surely you remember this. Anybody remembers what the equation for kinetic energy is? See, that's my field. You're moving, that's called energy of motion, kinetic energy. Anybody remember what that equation is, just offhand?
1/2 times mass times velocity squared.
I think I hear it. 1/2
times mass times velocity squared.
You got it. Exactly. That's kinetic energy. 1/2 mv squared. Relatively simple equation, but it represents some object in motion. Now, what are the variables in there in real life? Velocity is one. The mass. Okay. Now that's a very easy equation. Now which one, when you're going down the road, is going to be more meaningful?
The velocity.
The velocity, why?
Because it's squared.
It's squared. Now we begin to understand that equation. Now let me explain it to you in terms that you probably can understand even easier. And this is how I had to explain it to my clients back in the 70s. Take me, whatever I weigh, I'm right at 200 pounds. I'm going to take one step forward, 2 feet at a time. 2 feet per second. Okay? So what is my kinetic energy? 200 times 2 squared, right? Okay, so that's 4 times my weight mass.
200 by 2.
The 1/2 mv squared, the 1/2 mv. Not the v, but 1/2 m. Okay?
400.
That doesn't change, does it? When I take a step, it didn't change. Now, I'm going to stretch out and I'm going to go for 3 feet per second. Now, what do we have in the way of kinetic energy? I just increased 1 foot per second. Nine times the mass factor. Try that against this wall. You get the idea? What is that factor like when you're going 55?
Too much.
That's 80 squared. Actually, almost 81 squared. You know what the difference between 55 miles per hour and feet per second squared against 60? That's 80 against about 88, approximately. Those approximations. In engineering, it's okay if we approximate to understand the concept. It's when we get down to the nitty-gritty, we have to go to the decimals, okay? I think it's 1,232, if I'm not mistaken, is the change in the multiplier. Now, I tell you all this for practical purposes. Yes, sir?
I was going to say, I got hit by rear-ended going like 65 miles per hour on the highway by a small vehicle, and I thought it was a truck that hit me. She was sleeping, of course, but...
Well, you're absolutely right. Because We take bullets, we knock people down. We take large-sized bullets called automobiles, and we really knock the wick out of them. And we don't have to go near as fast as a bullet. I'll tell you, anything 35 and over, you're in bad shape if that bullet gets after you. Okay? Bad shape. But that's the concept that is one of the fundamentals of evaluating the collision process. How fast were you traveling? That's one of the variables at collision. Now there's another, by the way, what are we dealing with in the way of fundamental theory? Does anybody know where kinetic energy comes from, the fundamentals? Oh, come on. Anybody ever hear of Sir Isaac Newton?
Yeah, Newton's law.
There's I confess, I can never keep up on one, two, and three, but which is what? But that's going too deep for me to understand, but you know, I know what they mean, okay? There's another formula in mechanics. You learned it in physics, hopefully sophomores?
Yeah.
Learned in sophomore physics, in mechanics area. It's called momentum. Now that one required vector knowledge, didn't it? Okay, that's vector. Kinetic energy is scalar. That's where we just totaled it up. We know that if you're moving a certain speed and have a certain mass, and you've got kinetic energy, and if something happens that you change speed, then energy had to go somewhere, either into or out of it. And by the way, what's the other side of the equation on kinetic energy before we get away from it? Anybody remember that half of it? Force times distance. Force times distance,
work,
FD.
Work done.
In other words, to slow your kinetic energy down, there must be work done of some kind. Remember I told you a while ago about sound? That's one of them. You know, one of my thermal professors, he was great. How many of you take a thermal? Oh, bless you.
We don't offer it.
Oh, okay. Well, thermal is really for mechanical engineers for the most part. Others have to learn it. Aerospace have to learn specifically the thermal and fluid dynamics of that kind of field. But anyhow, I was taking thermal and one of the guys got very brave and he said, there are 1,252 formulas in the textbook for thermodynamics. I can't remember all those formulas. I will never forget the lecture that followed. It was beautiful. He said, listen closely. Input equals output. I didn't forget it, but you better believe it. In thermodynamics, there are five elements in thermodynamics. I'm not going to repeat them again because it's been a long time since I've done thermal, but I will tell you there are five, which means there's five on the left-hand side and there's five on the right-hand side of any equation. Input equals output, just like the theory of conservation of energy. Input equals output. If there's so much kinetic energy, there's got to be so much work done if that energy disappears because it's transformed. So the same thing in thermal, but input equals output. So kinetic energy equals work. What types of work? Well, there's the energy of things colliding. What happens when some metal bends metal? Well, it takes a force, work, to bend it, doesn't it? That's force times distance. So you create a tremendous force here, but not a lot of distance. But when it gives, Lord help you, there's the big give. And then it goes to zero. And then you pick up the next thing that gives resistance. Remember, you all do know that for every force, there's an equal and opposite reactive force, yes. Okay, we don't want to forget that. We tend to forget it, but it's there. You can't have force without a reactive force. So at any rate, and when the metal bends, what happens? Heat. You ever take a paper clip and bend it real like that, and then feel it. You'll feel the heat. So there's sound, there's heat. But in comparison to all that bending collision stuff, let's kick that out. Let's kick the sound out. Chemically, we don't have anything really reacting, except maybe the battery gives a last kick in there somehow to the starter or something, but not really measurable. So the big thing around here is collision damage. Now, in driving an automobile, did you ever hit the brakes for an accident, if you had one, or try to stop? Okay, that's working. You think you, what actually stops you? When you put your foot on that brake pedal, what happens? Anybody know? See, as an expert, you have to know all these things, which means as an expert in the field of automotive collisions, had to know the design of the automobile. Had to know the design of the highway, including the surface that the vehicle's riding on. Had to know about the tires. Coefficient of friction of the tires on the pavement. What happens if there's ice between your tires and the pavement? Now we don't have a very high coefficient of friction. What's the range for friction? Zero to one. Actually, you can get higher decelerated forces, but that's the ratio on the coefficient of friction. Okay. So you had to know about that. When I started back in 1974, I looked in the book for the value of coefficient of friction of tires on asphalt. They gave a single value. That doesn't take care of everything. What if the sun's shining on it? What if it's warm? What if the asphalt is faulted? That means that it's cut, the binders come apart, and now we've got little pieces of gravel that are rattling around like marbles. If you get on that, people, you can plow all the brakes you want to, but you're still going to go. There ain't much work going to be done riding on marbles. It's ball bearings, just like it, okay? And by the way, I saw a tractor trailer did exactly that one time. He locked her down, slid right across the intersection on that spalling pavement. He said, I'm applying my brakes. They made me check the brakes, but I was looking at the fact that he'd skidded across the intersection with tire marks here and there. He'd been trying, obviously. So there are a lot of things that go into being an expert. So how do I get 2 years after into a courtroom and get people to believe me? Well, your job as an expert is to take things that you know. By the way, did you all know that you are learning things that less than 2% of the population knows anything about? That's how exclusive a club you are joining. And you know what your reputation is going to be? Daddy, don't talk over our heads. Makes sense somehow, anyway. Don't try to explain it all to me, Daddy. I just want the answer. Your world changes when you gain knowledge in engineering. So you have to explain these technical things. Things that it took you hours and weeks and months to learn. In the courtroom, as a forensic engineer, by the way, forensic is a magic word that says I'm doing my engineering work for the legal system. That's all it means. And in practice, what it means is I got to watch my P's and Q's. I got to document everything so that they don't succeed in knocking me out of the courtroom. My job is to get to that courtroom with my knowledge if that's what my client wants me to get there. Now, if it's bad stuff, he usually says, thank you anyway, I'll pay my bill. By the way, they do pay their bill, one way or the other. Your job as a forensic engineer is to tell them what happened. You're not an advocate for the plaintiff, you're not an advocate for the defendant. You're an advocate for the judge, really, for Mother Nature, for the truth. That's what you're there for, okay? So you've got to document and gain credibility any way you can. There's the magic word, credibility. I want them to believe me when I get in that courtroom. I want my client to believe me, because I'm going to guarantee you most 50% of the time I explain to my client, I'm afraid your driver done screwed up and we owe some money. Here's what happened. And then after I explain it to you, you say, well, thank you anyway, here's your money, go away. By the way, in legal terms, you're called a consultant. You were there to find out what happened and explain to your client what happened. If it's in his favor, now he's going to say, I'm going to make you an expert witness. And at that point, everything you discovered is now discoverable, that's a magic word too, to the other side. They can ask all the questions they want, and you better believe they want your hide on the wall tanned. So your world changes in forensic engineering. Although you really should document everything you do anyway. Why? For your own safety part. You're smart if you do that, okay? Protect yourself as well. Everything you do, do that. Okay, Mr. Cox, you're in this courtroom now 3 years after it happened. You say you didn't get to see the automobiles 2 years after it happened. How is it that you do this magic thing? Biscuit dough, is that what you said, biscuit dough? Yes, sir. Explain biscuit dough to me. Well, that's easy enough. Take some biscuit dough and roll it out here on the table. Now I'll go out of the room, or I'll turn my back, however you want to do it. And one of y'all come up here and you put your hand in that biscuit dough. Okay? I want you to put your hand in biscuit dough twice. Don't care which hand, just put your hand in biscuit dough. Okay? Now I turn around, I don't have to look at the flower on your hand, see which hand was in biscuit dough. I can look at that biscuit dough and I say, aha, it was the left hand. The fingers were spread open. You had a ring on your third finger there. When you put the hand in the biscuit dough, you spread it a little bit like this, so you pushed on it while it was in the biscuit dough. By the way, you were standing on this side of the table as opposed to that, because I know how your hands attach your wrist, your arm, and your body. And I didn't have to be there when you did that. And that's just exactly what they do. Oh, I understand this. I understand this. And I'll tell you something else. Why two handprints? Because if the second handprint overlaps the first, I can tell you the sequencing. First handprint gets indented by the second. Now, they believe you. I did another one on momentum. You see, how y'all familiar with the fact that a seatbelt ties you to the automobile, so as the automobile slows, you slow with the automobile, right? Okay. If you don't have a seatbelt on, the automobile stops, you don't. Everybody understand that basic fundamental? That one everybody understand, okay. How can you tell that this person was the driver as opposed to the passenger? Well, I use what's called the shotgun principle. Shotgun principle. Explain me this shotgun's principle. Well, it's quite simple. My pappy taught me that if you put the shotgun tight against your shoulder, it shoves on you. Now it may bruise a little bit in there, but it ain't gonna break them bones. Okay? But guess what? If I don't pull that shotgun tight against my shoulder when I pull the trigger, boom, that hurt, and things break. Especially when it's a stock of a shotgun. It will break collarbones. Now most country people understand that kind of thing. Now why is this important? Well, in this particular case, it had a head-on collision. Two men were drunk. They were in a pickup truck on the wrong side of the road. And when they collided, their vehicle rotated 90 degrees in the impact. Wait a moment. We talked about impact being what? Less than a tenth of a second. Less than half the time it takes to blink. So what happens inside that truck? If it's going down the road at about 50 miles per hour, and then within less than a tenth of a second, it does a 90 degree turn. Okay, this is the driver over here on the left side. This is the passenger on the right side. Let's rotate them like this. The driver goes with the driver door, doesn't he? tied up against it, isn't it? But what about the passenger? The passenger's going to go across the cab like a loose cannon. Bam, bam. They told me that they found a man under the steering wheel badly injured. Since he was under the steering wheel, he must have been the driver. They found a man sitting on the open passenger door saying that he was the passenger. He wasn't badly injured. I said, which way did the vehicle rotate? They said, clockwise. I says, you got the wrong man, because they charged the man under the steering wheel. I said, but I will have to see the evidence before I can offer an opinion in courtroom to that effect, to confirm the evidence that you just told me. And I looked, and sure enough, it had rotated 90 degrees during the impact process. And therefore, the injured man who spent 6 weeks in the hospital was actually the passenger. And when I looked at the pickup truck, I found a pair of knee prints in the dashboard right below the radio. I found an indentation in the steering wheel from the radial side, not from the top down like a driver would be into it, but from the side. In other words, instead of a pure circle, it had a little moon shape in it. The injured man had a chest injury. The injured man had a head injury as well. But guess what? Over on the driver's, actually the passenger side of the windshield post, in other words, to the right of the left windshield post, there was another dent where a head had gone into it, or something like shaped like a head. So, I was able to testify who the driver was and who the passenger was, based upon biscuit dogs and the shotgun principle. You see, part of the problem is an expert witness. When you go into a jury, and that's who you've got to deal with most of the time. You have judge trials as well, but most of them are jury trials. The jury may have any kind of education. See, if you're in a classroom of, let's say, advanced algebra, I know what you're supposed to know about algebra and math coming up to that level, right? So I know you're supposed to know this, and we go from there. I build upon that knowledge. But when you go in the courtroom, you have no idea what level of knowledge these people have. And so you have to make it simple, such as I just described. You know what the problem is today? Today they think I can do everything Abby can. Abby has the equivalent of about half a dozen PhDs. That woman is a miracle to know as many different fields as she knows on that show. I'm talking NCIS for any of you that haven't guessed yet. Or CSI or whatever they are. They like to do their little magic in the laboratory and all this forensic information. But they can't do it all. It's imaginary. Sometimes you can do it, but Lord, you got to have all those many thousands, well, millions of dollars worth of equipment. And if you're an independent investigator, you don't have that kind of equipment. So you have to make shift to do other things to find a way to get there. That's your handicap as an individual. By the way, the manufacturers all have their experts in laboratories, so you're really fighting a battle. If it is a manufacturing defect that you're working against, that's a forensic engineer's life. And you can't trust anybody but yourself and your knowledge. And you can't trust yourself, you have to double check yourself. You have to make very sure that you have not. The reason is because you cannot make a mistake. Well, cannot make a mistake? If you make a mistake, the other attorney's going to say, you lied, you cheated, you stole. You're just trying to beat up on my client. That's what they'll make you out. So you cannot afford a mistake. Now, that's a forensic engineer, and I'm going to switch that into any kind of engineer. A doctor kills one patient if he makes a mistake. If you're an engineer, you can kill hundreds and thousands. One of the things that I like to promote is I want you all to go to the top. I want you to learn everything you can know about your field. And by the way, you can't know it all. You can't be an Abby in real life. Pick your specialty and make yourself the best in it. I recommend that you get a few years practice when you get that degree. Learn inside out. I had the kinetic energy equation in physics. I had it in mechanics in college. But I didn't understand it until I got out and saw it in the collision damage of vehicles. When I got experienced, I could walk down the damage of a vehicle and tell you, this is the first tenth of a second, this is the second, not tenth of a second, 10 milliseconds. This is the second 10 milliseconds, this is the third. I could tell you by looking at it, which vehicle was traveling the fastest going into the collision. Think about it for a moment.
Count some problems.
35 miles per hour is about 50 feet per second. Okay? 50 feet per second. How far does it travel in a tenth of a second? If you use the slide rule, you know that it's 5 feet. Okay? By the way, can anybody do the multiplication tables up to 12? Okay, I'm going to give you another. Y'all take this for what it's worth, okay? If you do not use it, you lose it. It sounds mundane, but I'm going to guarantee you, I have forgotten more than I ever learned. Okay? I kid you not. If you do not use it, you will lose it. If you don't go through the multiplication tables every once in a while, you will not know what 5 times 7 is.
35.
We had to think about it. You got to get good with numbers. Okay? Because that's what an engineer is about. You've got to be able to work with numbers. Anybody know the conversion for feet per second and miles per hour? How to go back and forth? Roughly 1.47 times your miles per hour will give you feet per second. I use 1.5 for engineering purposes, just to get me in the ballpark. Then when we get serious, I'll get down to 1.4687 something, anyhow, whatever it is. Okay? But in your mind, you need to know and understand how to convert from miles per hour to feet per second, or any other unit conversion that you're going to be dealing with. Because when you input data to a computer, remember I said the computer's stupid. You got to check its answer. And if you don't know the answer, at least ways in rough terms, then you don't belong with the name of engineer. If you have to Google it, and that's, one of the professors was screaming at us the other day, he says, they're Googling the answers. He said, I just got back from California testifying against some structural engineer. He relied on a software program. His excuse when it failed was that, well, my peers had tested it. If he didn't know that it gave him the wrong answer, he didn't need the label of engineer. It's that simple. The slide rule was a tool. The computer is a tool. Now, I'm not putting computer programmers or computer science down one bit, because we rely upon them to be able to give us more knowledge, just as I rely upon that slide rule to give me more knowledge. But I didn't believe a slide rule anymore, and I believe a computer. Now, Bud Peterson, president of Georgia Tech, the other day talked to professional engineers last July. They're teaching a course over there, and I don't remember which one, where they decided to use, everybody know what Watson is? IBM? Watson plays chess and works, what is it, Jeopardy? They decided to take the Watson platform and convert it into a girl. And that girl answered the phone and talked to students of his class, professor's class. They didn't know they was talking to a computer. It wasn't if you speak English, push one. It was from the get-go when she heard your voice. She recorded your voice. The next time she called, you called her, she says, "Oh, hello, Jethro. It's good to talk with you again." They're trying to fool you with computers, people. They got up to, he said they had a 97% confidence that she was giving you the right answer. I said, "What happened to the other 3%? How do we resolve that one?" They said, "Well, the technical assistants took care of that." And I says, "Oh, and the technical assistants know it all?" I make a little fun. I'm a maverick. I question everything. If you can't convince me, I don't believe it. Okay? That's from long, long years of a lot of people have tried a lot of things on me. But the things I learned, and I learned them well, I said, do something to convince me that something's different that I can rely upon. And that's the life of a forensic engineer. I'm taking up too much time on it. I apologize. This will be an hour. Well, at any rate, what I'd like to wind up with is that you can't be a forensic engineer until you're an expert in something. You've got a lot of years before you to work that out. I'm going to ask you to do this for me because I think you will find it the most helpful advice you ever received. Right now, I know your goal is to make at least 85 on the exam. I'm asking you to think beyond that 85 and say, this is a subject that I intend to get into or what I'm interested in. I want to know more about it. Go beyond the 100% because they don't teach you everything on the 100%. Okay? They cannot. They don't have the time. It's not a condemnation. It's a time factor. You pay for so much time, and that's what they give you. And that's what you can absorb, and that's where it sits. By the way, I've been a teacher most of my life, starting in high school. So I know what this teaching stuff is about. I want you to learn everything you can learn about it, and then I want you to apply and get your license, the professional engineering license. And why do I want you to do that? Because my experience was, I didn't need it when I worked for the government and helped send missiles into the air and intercept other missiles. By the way, you better hope that technology I worked on in the 60s when I was in aerospace business in Huntsville worked, because some guy over there in North Korea may test it. And I'm serious about that. I surely hope it works. Although I know Israel's been using it for a considerable time. It's just a matter of, do we have enough of them to do the job, as far as I can tell. But at any rate, I'm sorry, I sidestepped there. I didn't get my professional engineering license until 16 years after I left Texas A&M. I'm going to tell you that it was touch and go. I didn't make 100. I found out what it was I didn't know and went to work and studied it before I went any farther. Even with a license, you won't get 100. You very seldom do. But get that license, and here's what it gives you. You may not know it, but the moment that you become an engineer, you take that diploma, and you walk across state, you get that diploma, you accept a responsibility for everybody in the world. Your decisions, directly, indirectly. For that reason, your work is supposed to be supervised by a licensed professional engineer who's shown that two things. One, he is morally fit. In other words, he wants to do the right thing, the truth. And he wants to see that nobody gets hurt by what we do. And secondly, he knows the limitations of his work. Until you know the limitations of that equation I just gave you, you shouldn't use it. Sure, you know it. You can put any number you want to into it. Play with the numbers all you want to. But they will not have meaning until you know that they fit reality of what it is that you're applying it to. And that takes experience, practical experience. And so your practical experience will be guided by a licensed professional engineer if you are very lucky. And then one day when you think you've known enough, and they say a minimum of 4 years of practice, take the exam, the license exam. There's one exam upon graduation. That's strictly the curriculum. You won't have any trouble passing if you'll take it right there when you graduate, get your diploma, okay? 4 years later, you can take the professional exam. What you just got was something I call freedom. Because I worked for 4 years under the supervision of another engineer, a professional engineer, until I got my license. I got my license, I could walk, and I did, and formed my own company. I was my own boss. Now, it comes a responsibility with it because there's no one there to guide you now, and it's up to you to know that you made the right decision. And you will have a little seal that says, I hereby certify these drawings or these plans. And the lives of hundreds and thousands of people may rest upon that knowledge and that signature. That's how great you all are going to be when you get to be engineers. And it is so much fun to get out there and do what you're going to be doing because you have the tools I didn't have. You're learning things I didn't get to learn the easy way over the hard way. And new technologies come along every day. And you're the ones, in fact, well, you're getting a little old and you might be long in the tooth for going to Mars. But they're talking about tunnels on Mars, on Moon now. But y'all can put them there. You can ship them youngins off to Mars. It can be you. That's one way to get rid of your kids. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Y'all are a great group. I'm looking forward to what you all do for the future. I've had my fun and I've retired and I'm just looking around and saying, y'all be careful. Y'all be careful because it's dangerous out there. You're the people that knows whether it's dangerous or not. Nobody else. By the way, you do know what happened on the Challenger, don't you? Managers overrode the engineer. He wasn't a PE. He really didn't have the hind legs. He said, when you get that PE, by law, once you get that PE, you are it. No manager can tell you, do it. You say, no, it will kill people. I will not be a part of it. And if you try and go forward, I will tell the authorities. That's your job. You are it. You are the authority. Isn't that something? That's where y'all are headed. All you gotta do is get a few A's and B's around here and you march right on. It's been my pleasure. Thank you so very much.